Hello and welcome to Health and Wellness here on CBSNews.com. I'm Callie Carlin with Dr. Jennifer Ashton. Today we're turning the tables a little bit. Usually you're asking the questions. Right. Today you're going to answer them. Now, you just returned from 8 days of coverage in Haiti, and we've obviously seen a lot of your coverage. Great job reporting. But what we'd like to hear is the behind the scenes story of what this was like for you as a physician and a journalist to cover.
Well, first of all, Callie, I had made the decision to go down there purely as a physician. In fact, I actually traveled down there with a medical team. I was stationed with a medical team, and I traveled with a nurse, Babette Ammerman, who came from New Jersey with me, who just heard that I was going down, really wanted to help. And she and I worked, about 10 to 12 hours a day at a tent hospital taking care of patients.
How did this experience compare to anything you've ever seen before as a health professional, as a doctor, and as a journalist?
Medically, it was beyond anything that I could have possibly imagined. So many people likened it to combat situations. I mean, there were hundreds and thousands of injured people, seriously injured. Almost every patient at our tent hospital had an open or compound fracture of their leg, gangrene and infection setting in, critical dehydration, and the amount of supplies and materials that we had to work with clinically, again, was almost non-existent. We had no oxygen. We had no real anesthesia. We were using the equivalent of conscious sedation to do amputations there. So what we did have was antibiotics. We had some pain medication. There was a day where we completely ran out of morphine. Mm-hmm. We had IV fluids. And little by little, every day, some more supplies would come in. But as soon as they would come in, that's how quickly we would use them.
Was there any experience in particular that will stay with you forever?
Oh, there were almost too many to count. I think the ones that personally I will never forget, one was the very first night that we were there, and about 3 o'clock in the morning, a South Florida search and rescue team brought to our tent hospital a 15-year-old girl that they had extricated after 3 days of being under rubble by amputating her arm at the site. And the lead search and rescuer, who was actually an emergency medicine physician named Dr. Mark Grossman, recounted to me how it was such close quarters that he actually couldn't wear his hard hat when he went in there to bring this girl out, and that there was actually a dead body on top of her. And every time and her arm was pinned, so they amputated her arm right above the elbow. They put a blood pressure cuff on it, inflated it so that there wouldn't be a hemorrhage. And as he started to try and amputate her arm, first with a scalpel, then with a handsaw, then finally with an electric saw, it was so tight that every time he moved the saw, the person behind him had to pull him back an inch because there was just no space in which to work. And they brought that girl, that 15-year-old, to our tent hospital, and we resuscitated her for about an hour and a half, closed off the blood vessels that were obviously just raw in her arm. And just to see that, one nurse actually fainted during this resuscitation, is so different. You just don't see someone in that condition, even in a hospital, because by the time the doctors and nurses get to that person, they're in a hospital gown, they're in a sterile environment. This was on a card table under a tree in the middle of the night, with holding flashlights. There were babies that we took care of that we were able to arrange airlift to Miami, where they probably will survive. They would have never survived if left in Haiti.
There was some controversy and questions surrounding the level of involvement of mm-hmm. some journalists there. What do you say to the critics who think that the journalists got too emotionally attached with this story?
Well, I think my first reaction when I was down there and heard of that was it falls under the context of no good deed goes unpunished. Basically, there are a handful of doctors who have kind of segued into secondary careers as medical journalists, of which I am definitely part of that small group. And almost all of us, when we were down there, felt primarily our responsibility was as a medical professional. And when you take the Hippocratic Oath, that supersedes anything you do in front of the camera. Now, I think people might have had a problem with the fact that cameras were capturing us doing what we were doing.
That's a huge part of the story.
But that aspect needs to be explained to people. And I think that for the most part, the physicians who were medical journalists who went down there, and I didn't see any of the other coverage, so I only know what I was actually doing. I really find it difficult to believe that those people had a conflict. I think when you're a doctor and you have dedicated your life sometimes 30 years or more to helping others, when you see someone in need, that drive is almost reflexive.
Looking forward, what do you think will continue to be the greatest health challenges for Haiti?
I think when you think about what they're going to be facing in the future, you really need to understand where they were before the quake, which was horrendous. They have a very high prevalence of HIV and AIDS in their population. There's a lot of tuberculosis. There's a lot of malnutrition. Very few of their children get routine immunizations. So they are already a population at significant medical risk. And now there are so many hundreds and hundreds of people who have had amputations. All of those patients will need crutches, wheelchairs, prosthetic limbs. They don't have any of that there. And if an amputee does not get that type of rehabilitation, their overall life expectancy can be dramatically reduced. So while the amputation saved their life in the short term, their quality of life is really up in the air at this point. And those are just the amputees. I mean, there are obviously, as we've heard, so many thousands of children who have been orphaned and people who are really now pushed over the brink in terms of their medical and physical condition by this disaster.